Well, good morning. It is lovely to see you at our second service here in Glen Abbey. And if you're watching on our live stream, it's great that you're able to join with us as well. I also want to thank our guest speaker again this week is Alan Wilson. And we've really appreciated his time and teaching over this Easter period. And having listened to him in our first service, I know that you're really going to be challenged by what he shares with us today. Thanks also to Ian Thompson and the band for leading us this morning in our time of praise. Next week, Chris is going to be starting a 12-week spring series, which is entitled Stepping Forward Together, Being the Body of Christ in a Post-Pandemic World. Through this series, we trust that we will be able to take stock of where we are as a church after such a challenging 13 months and begin to lift our eyes to how God might be guiding our next steps forward together. Also next weekend, we will be having a communion on Sunday evening, and this will also be live streamed so that everyone can join with us from home if they're unable to attend in person. Next weekend's services, both the two services, the half nine, half 11, and Sunday evening communion, tickets for those will become available at 2 p.m. this afternoon. We're going to take time now to pray together. And as we do, I want us to just to listen to some words that we find in Paul's letter to the church in Rome. This is what he says. If we believe in our hearts that Jesus rose from the dead, and we confess with our mouth that he is Lord, we will be saved. As we take time to praise God together this morning, let us consider the words that we will be singing, the truths that we will be declaring, and may we truly worship God together this morning in spirit and in truth. Heavenly Father, thank you for this time when we can gather together in person and in our homes to worship you, to hear from you, to be with you as your chosen people, as a group of people who are deeply flawed yet at the same time deeply loved by you. We are in awe of you. We are overwhelmed by the outpouring of your love for us as demonstrated by sending your son Jesus into this world to take himself the punishment we deserve. Thank you for providing a way for us to be saved by putting our trust and faith in the finished work of Jesus on the cross. Thank you that Jesus is alive today, that the grave and death could not hold him, and help us to enter into the reality of this wonderful truth that if we confess with our mouth that he is Lord, we will be saved. This morning, we are so conscious of our need to pray for our leaders. We thank you for the men and women who serve our country in leadership roles and for their families. We pray for kings, or in our case, for the queen and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. We know that your word says that this is good and is pleasing to God, who wants all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. Help us, Lord. Help us to be light in the darkness, to be peacemakers where you have placed us. We pray that you would encourage those who work for peace in this land during this time of increased tension and hostilities. We pray for peace to prevail and for people to turn towards you rather than turning against each other. Father, we continue to pray for those in our church family and those we know who have recently lost a loved one. We know that grief is painful. And the journey it takes us on is our own journey to travel. And so we pray for those who are grieving, that you will be present with them to comfort and strengthen and to help in their time of need. We pray also for those who are ill. Some are ill with the virus and others recovering from its effects. Some are struggling with difficult prognoses and which require challenging treatments. And Lord, we pray for them this morning. May they know the sense of your loving embrace at this time. Father, we also pray for our young people as they return to school this week, many who haven't been at school for quite some time. We pray that you would help them to settle in and adjust to what once was a familiar routine, but will probably feel like a new routine now. We pray for their teachers who have to deal with additional workload and changes to their teaching environment. May this week be a good week for all involved. Thank you, Lord, for reminding us that when we need help, we're to ask you. And so we pause now and individually ask for your help for those that we know, for our own situations. Help us, Lord. Father, thank you for hearing our prayer. And as we sing your praise this morning, may your name be lifted up and glorified. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand. Almighty, Song because of the doctrine and the truths that are in it, that God the Father, Jesus Christ the Son, and the resurrection are such important things that we believe in. But if it's just a thing that we believe in and it doesn't go any further than that, then there's something wrong with our experience. And it says in Jeremiah 31:3, the Lord said, I have loved you with an everlasting love. I have drawn you with unfailing kindness. And it's that God that touches our heart, the heart of flesh that he's given us. And it's that relationship that is key in why we're here this morning, why we worship him, why we love him, because of his death and resurrection for us. So let's take this opportunity to just worship him, to sing these songs and the truths that we're singing that would just glorify his lovely name this morning. I love you, Lord. And I lift my voice to worship you, oh my soul, rejoice, take joy, my King. Thank you. Listen to your word, that you would just bless it to our hearts, that we would long to know you more, that we would long to have a depth of knowledge of you, and that you would just glorify your lovely Son. We love you and we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Please have a seat.
Well, good morning, and it's good to be with you again. And we're going to carry on this week the theme of Easter. And so if you have a Bible, I want to invite you to turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And we're going to read a number of verses from that chapter. It's a long chapter. We're not going to read it all, but we're going to read a number of verses from early in the chapter and then one verse right at the end of the chapter. So if you want to follow the reading, it's 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and I'm beginning at verse 12. But if it is preached, this is Paul writing to the Corinthian church, but if it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. More than that, we are then found to be false witnesses about God, for we have testified about God that he raised Christ from the dead. But he did not raise him if, in fact, the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. And then right down to the end of the chapter, verse 58, which ends on a much different note, a much more positive note, he says, therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. And may God bless his word to us as we reflect on it this morning. On Good Friday, just 10 days ago, I know it probably seems a lot longer ago, but on Good Friday, there was a tweet on Twitter, obviously, and it was an Easter-themed tweet. It stirred quite a response. Some of you who are into your Twitter may have come across it. The author was a professor, Professor Alice Roberts, from the University of Birmingham, and here is what she tweeted. She said, just a little reminder today. Remember, it's Good Friday. Just a little reminder today. Dead people don't come back to life. Now, I think that the tweet managed to attract about 11,500 likes, and that's an indicator that for one reason or another, what she tweeted was obviously a very popular opinion. Which means on the weekend when many of us were thinking about the events that we believe took place in the first Easter, the death of the Lord Jesus, his burial, and his rising to life again on the Sunday, while we were celebrating that, there were other people And they were trying to do what they could to dampen the flames of what they reckon is just some kind of superstition, an empty superstition. Quite a difference of opinion. Just as there was centuries ago. Another professor, this time Professor N.T. Wright, who's a New Testament scholar, has written about some of the diverse views that there were in the ancient world on the subject of what happens at death. Some people, he says, believed that death was permanent. And he quotes from a play, an ancient Greek play, where Apollo proclaims that once a man has died and the dust has dried up his blood or soaked up his blood, there is no resurrection. Others thought that there were opportunities for heroic characters who could be taken straight to heaven without having to go through death. And others, again, believed that some of the folk who had lived faithful lives would be rewarded for their faithfulness by being returned to life at some point in the future. Whole range of views. Now, what we've read this morning from 1 Corinthians chapter 15 indicates to us that there were people in Corinth, the city that housed this church to which Paul was writing, there were people in that ancient city who were precisely on the same lines as Professor Alice Roberts was 10 days ago. Some things don't change. As the book of Ecclesiastes says, there is nothing new under the sun. So if they'd had Twitter in Corinth back in the day, they would have been tweeting along with her, dead people don't come back to life. Now, the problem was that that was not simply an opinion that was held by people in the culture outside of the church. There evidently were people within the church who held that belief. That's what Paul has heard. That's what he says in verse 12. People within the church who were denying the concept of resurrection. And Paul has to address it. Because as far as Paul is concerned, his argument runs like this. If there is no such thing as people being raised from the dead, well then not even Christ himself has been raised from the dead. And if Christ himself has not been raised from the dead, then the gospel itself collapses. There is no gospel. There is no point in believing. There is no hope. And if Christ has not been raised from the dead, then his followers are misguided and miserable, of all people to be pitied. And we would be far better off, Paul basically says, just embracing the hedonism, the live for the present of the surrounding culture. Now, the function of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, it's one of those parts of the New Testament that sets out to explore the implications of Christ being raised from the dead. It's the gospel writers in those last couple of chapters or so of each of their gospels. It's the gospel writers who give us more detail about the empty tomb and who was there and who went to visit and what they saw and what happened when Jesus appeared to people. That's where you get those fascinating stories at the end of the Gospels. But 1 Corinthians is one of those chapters not so much concerned to give us lots of details about the appearances of Jesus after he'd been raised again, although 1 Corinthians 15 says a little bit about it. But there are these other passages then that are passages that are saying, well, so what? What are the implications of Christ being raised from the dead? What difference does it make? And chapter 15, 1 Corinthians, goes into a lot of that in quite some detail. It's a long chapter. It's 58 verses. And we're only going to be able to touch on some of the highlights in the time that we have available to us this morning. If you want, you can think of it as an Easter postscript. Just the same way that you probably still have the remnants of Easter eggs in your house from a week ago, and you're still munching on them. It's like an Easter postscript. So today is an Easter postscript. Last week, we thought about the Mark's account of the disappearance of the body from the grave. And that scene as the women came and left in fear and trembling because of the enormity and the incomprehensibility of what had happened. We thought about that event last week, and today we're going to think a little bit about some of the implications. Now, Paul's initial focus in the chapter is on, well, let's just talk about what happens if Christ has not been raised. Notice verse 14, if Christ has not been raised, and he begins to work on some of the implications of that. A little bit later in verse 20, just beyond where we stopped our reading, in verse 20 he changes the tone. When he makes this affirmation, he says, but Christ has indeed been raised from the dead. That's what Paul believed, and that is what changed everything. Now, here's what we're going to try to cover in the next little bit of time. Look again at verse 14. Three things. Look again at verse 14. If Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless. That's quite a claim for a preacher to make. Our preaching is useless. But if Christ has not been raised, that's the reality of it. The content of Paul's message is an empty, futile piece of content. Now, to frame that more positively, which is what we want to try to do, if Jesus has been raised, as we affirmed last week at Easter Sunday, if Jesus has indeed been raised, then our message of the gospel is not meaningless. So if Jesus has been raised, our message is not meaningless. Look a little further in verse 14. If Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith, he says. So secondly, if we flip that around, we can say this. If Jesus has been raised, then our faith is not futile. Our message is not meaningless, and our faith is not futile. And then jump all the way down to the end of the chapter. In the final section of the chapter, what Paul has been doing there is expounding the nature of the transformation that's going to come about when the followers of Jesus, in their turn, are raised from the dead. Verse 57 says, God gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And that's followed up with this in verse 58. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. In other words, if Jesus has been raised, our work is not worthless. So our message is not meaningless, our faith is not futile, and our work is not worthless. Let's just take a few moments to think about each of these in a little bit more detail. First of all, our message is not meaningless. Now, I'm sure lots of us have played the game Jenga at various times. Just to remind you how it works, you got a cardboard box, and inside the cardboard box is a collection of wooden blocks. And they come assembled into the shape of a tower, and you take the box away, and there's the tower. And the idea of the game is that the people who are participating have to take it in turns to remove one block at a time. And you keep going until some unfortunate person moves one particular block, and it's the wrong one. And what's left of the tower by that stage collapses. End of the game, or at least end of the round. One block out, the whole thing collapses. Now, in terms of the gospel, let me put it like this. If you take away the resurrection of Jesus, the whole thing collapses. Now, I know that there are folks who don't like to think like that. There are folks who like to think that any doctrine is up for grabs and you can take it out and look at it and tweak it here and there, and it doesn't really affect the message. I don't think Paul would agree with that. Paul seems to be saying very clearly in 1 Corinthians 15 that if Jesus has not been raised from the dead, then the stuff I've been preaching to you, he says, well, it's just empty nonsense. If Christ has not been raised. But if Jesus has been raised, our message is not meaningless. Now, right at the beginning of the chapter, where he starts is that he talks about the events that stand at the heart of the gospel, this good news of what God has done through Jesus, the message he's preached, the message the Corinthians have received. Look at the start of the chapter. He says in verse 1, "I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel you are saved, if you hold firmly to the word I preached to you. Otherwise, you have believed in vain." Don't drift away from it. Maybe that's the language that Hebrews would use at that point. Don't drift away from it. If you hold firmly to this message, you're saved. Otherwise, you've believed in vain. And then he says this in verse 3. For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures. And then he goes on to talk about various appearances of Jesus after he had been raised. What you need to notice there is at the very heart of what Paul preached was a series of historical events. Christ had died. Christ had been buried. Christ had been raised. And the evidence that he had been raised was in this whole series of appearances to Peter, to the 12, to a group of over 500 believers all at the same time, to James, to all of the apostles, and to Paul himself in a very remarkable way. Paul's message is based on a series of actual events. It's not a philosophy that he has somehow pulled out of the air, or that he has dreamt up as he spent some time meditating in the desert. It's a message that is grounded in a series of things that actually happened. Now notice also this, there's a little phrase that occurs twice, according to the Scriptures. It's applied both to the fact that Christ had died and to the fact that he had been raised again. Now what that means is that what happened to Jesus wasn't that something had gone wrong. It wasn't that Jesus had come along and he was a wonderful teacher and a healer and a miracle worker and an ethicist and all of those things, and something had happened and he'd fallen out of favor with the powers that be, and they killed him and nobody was expecting it, and suddenly God had to scramble around and find a rescue plan. He died according to the Scriptures. He was raised according to the Scriptures. And what that means is that the Old Testament actually anticipated those events that were going to take place. Now, you probably realize, as you read the Gospels, you realize that one of the points of tension in the Gospels is that the disciples, these people who spent so much time with Jesus, they didn't see this. They'd missed it. Even though it was there, it was hidden from their sight. And so when he began to talk about going to Jerusalem and people were going to take him and they were going to kill him, you got Peter jumping forward and saying, no, I'm never going to let this happen. And then after he had died and been buried, people didn't know what to do. The disciples didn't know what to do with this report of an empty tomb, because the last thing they expected was to see Jesus again. So they didn't really get it, but it was there. And Paul is able to say now, with the benefit of hindsight, and of course the apostles had the benefit of the teaching of Jesus, who opened their eyes to see what the Scriptures had to say about him, and Paul's able to look back and say, well, this was all God's plan. This happened according to the Scriptures. And then notice one other little detail that Paul adds this. He adds this to the simple fact of Jesus' death. He says, he died for our sins. It's a sacrifice for our sins. The cross of Jesus is the place where the justice of God and the love of God meets as he lays down his life for our sins. And Paul said, that's just fundamental to what I have preached to you. Now remember the Jenga blocks. Remember what happens if we take out raised on the third day, according to the scriptures. Take that out, and the tower collapses. Or as Paul puts it in verse 14, he says, our preaching is useless. In fact, he says it's even worse than that. Because not only is our preaching useless, but we've been found to be false witnesses about God. We've been telling lies about God because we said that he raised Jesus from the dead and he didn't. Now let me bring in verse 20. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead. Now that means that the gospel is not meaningless. Now our culture, just like that of Corinth, just like that to some extent of Paul's friends, Jewish friends, may very well stumble over parts of the gospel message. We've already commented on the intellectual sneering at the idea of a dead man rising. And of course, if we go and take a step back just a few days before the idea of a dead man rising, even the idea of boasting about a cross, boasting about the death by torture of an innocent man, it probably seems like nonsense to some people. Why on earth would you put that at the heart of your message? Maybe even offensive nonsense. Sacrifice. Why would you have to have sacrifice? What kind of a God is that? And when you start singing something like the old hymn or the old song, which we will be singing at the end of the service, Jesus, keep me near the cross, and we sing, in the cross, be my glory ever, that really doesn't seem to make a lot of sense, does it? Either the cross or the resurrection, neither of them seem to make much sense to our culture. And yet Paul was convinced that the message that he preached was the power and the wisdom of God. That's how he wrote about it in the earlier chapters of his letter to the church in Corinth. He realized that there were people who just saw the message of the cross as weakness and foolishness. But he said it is the power and wisdom of God. And he wrote to another church, the church in Rome, that the gospel is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes. Now, the reason that this idea of resurrection is so important here is this. It is what transforms the cross. The verdict of the cross is condemnation. Not Jesus being condemned because of anything he had done, but being condemned in our place. Rising again reverses the verdict. And the verdict of the resurrection is vindication. Jesus is vindicated. And wonderfully, so is everyone who puts their faith in him. Our message is not meaningless. Second thing then is that our faith is not futile. We come back to Paul's argument if Jesus has not been raised, and back to verse 14. So if Jesus has not been raised, he says, our message is meaningless, but also our faith is futile. Maybe I should put it like this. If Jesus has not been raised, you and I have been sold a dud. We've been scammed. I read a story the other day about a farmer in England, and he needed a new tractor. He couldn't afford the £20,000 or whatever it was to get the new model of the tractor that he wanted or he would have liked. So he found a tractor on eBay, £8,500. He transferred the money, and of course there was no tractor. It was just one of many scams. Now, that farmer had believed what he'd read on eBay. He saw there's an offer of a tractor, this is the amount of money. He took what was being said on eBay at its word. He trusted the person who was at the other end of the deal. But there was no tractor. His faith was futile. And if Jesus has not been raised from the dead, so is ours. We have been scammed. Now, Paul highlights a couple of particular losses if Christ has not been raised, that our faith is futile. In verse 17, he points out that if Christ has not been raised, there is no forgiveness. We are still in our sins. Now, we've just seen how the gospel has something to say about our sins. Christ has died for them. But what becomes clear is that without him rising again, his death is not enough. If Jesus has not been raised, he's not been vindicated. If he's not been vindicated, there's no vindication for us. We're still in our sins. There's no forgiveness. But also, if he's not been raised, verse 18 and 19, our faith is futile and there is no hope. He says, we are of all people to be pitied. So he says in verse 18, then those who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. Not only, in other words, not only has our past not been forgiven, but we have no future. And he thinks about this and he says, you know, in so many words, if we have no future beyond the several decades that we have in this lifetime, why would we deny ourselves? Why would we inconvenience ourselves for the sake of the gospel? Why would we be even like Paul and put ourselves in danger for the sake of the gospel? If you've got no future beyond this lifetime, then what you need to do is to squeeze as much as you possibly can from the present moment, because that's all you're going to get. Eat, drink, for tomorrow we die. That's how he puts it in verse 32. He's quoting from Isaiah chapter 22, where people are facing judgment and calamity, and instead of turning to God and humbling themselves, they say, do you know what? We're done for. Let's just eat, drink, and be merry because tomorrow we die. That was their philosophy. And Paul says, if Jesus has not been raised, you might as well have that philosophy. Live for the present, because there's no forgiveness for your past and there's no future that goes beyond this lifetime. But again, you go back to verse 20. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead. And so if Jesus has been raised, our faith is not futile. We've not poured our £8,500 into an account on eBay only to discover that there's no deal at the other end of it. In fact, if Christ has been raised, then our sins have been forgiven and we have been made clean. And our hope is not limited to our lifetime. And those who have fallen asleep in Christ have not been lost. And when you put that together, we can still live life to the full, but we don't live life to the full because the present is all there is and we have to try to squeeze as much from it as we possibly can. But we can live life to the full because our past has been forgiven and our future has been made secure. Our faith is not futile. So our message is not meaningless, and our faith is not futile. Finally, this in verse 58. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Our work is not worthless. You know, it's the prospect of being forgotten that makes death a difficult prospect for some people. A few years ago, there was an article in one of the national newspapers. It was written by an atheist, and he was writing about death. And he was saying how death is a dreadful thing. He was afraid of it. And he reckoned that when he died, his brain would disintegrate, and there would be nothing left of who he was. And 100 years after his death, no one would really even know who he was. For a generation or two, he'll live on in the memories of the people who'll know him, but just for a generation or two, and that's it. Fairly fatalistic view of what happens. Now, our news has obviously been dominated in the past few days by the death of Prince Philip, just a couple of months short of his 100th birthday. A remarkable lifespan. He was a complex character. But one of the things that's uncontroversial about him is that he was a hard worker. You know, sometimes we're thinking to ourselves, well, when I get to 55, and this is not me because I've passed 55, but, you know, someone like David Mayers, you know, when I can make it to 55, well, I'm sorry, he's a wee bit beyond it as well. But you know the idea, if I get to 55, I'll have enough money set aside in my retirement, and I can just sort of, you know, take it easy. 55, I'll retire. There, this man was still going at 95. 96, he was still working away, all these official engagements and so on, and only retired 4 years ago. He was involved with almost 800 organizations, obviously including the award scheme that carries his name. I started that award scheme many, many years ago. I think it's probably too late for me to go back. Didn't really get very far on it, so I never got to meet Prince Philip. But obviously, millions of people have gone through the Duke of Edinburgh Award Scheme. Maybe some of you have. Maybe some of you got to meet him when you received your award at the end of all of that. But that scheme, and much of the other work that he was involved in, like work, for example, with the Worldwide Fund for Nature, that will be part of his legacy. There will be things of value that outlast him. He'll be remembered in the legacy of his work. What about us? What about somebody like Paul, for example, who gives his life for the work of the gospel? And maybe you don't put yourself in the same category as Paul, but what about somebody who turns down a particular career opportunity because they know that if they take that career path, it will limit the opportunity that they have to be intentional about how they bring God into their work and how they seek first the kingdom of God in their workplace. Now, I'm not saying everybody needs to head off as a full-time missionary, at least in the way that it's traditionally understood. Whatever your vocation is, the encouragement of Scripture is to work at it as if you were doing your work for the Lord. But I think Paul, when he talks about the work that's involved in verse 58, I think he's probably being more specific. And the question is then, if Christ has not been raised, and we therefore will not be raised either, then our life is just going to end in oblivion, and why would we spend it doing anything for God? But Paul says, if Christ has been raised, then what we do for God has purpose and it has meaning. And because Christ has been raised, we can stand firm and we can give ourselves fully to this. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, he says, stand firm. Maybe some of us need to be reminded of that this morning. Maybe we've started to just totter a little bit. Like the Jenga tower, another way we can think about the Jenga tower. Some of us are maybe, we've become a little bit like that. Or we've become a little bit weary. Or the winds of the culture and the voices of the intellectual sneering, it just becomes a bit much after a time and we're wondering. And we need to hear freshly these words. But Christ has been raised. Therefore, stand firm. Don't topple over. Stand firm. Stand firm on this message. Stand firm on this reality. And as you stand firm, be willing to invest your life in serving God. And for some of you, that might be vocational. It might be a very distinct change of direction. For others of you, it may just be an adjustment of priorities to make room for what it is to live intentionally for God and His glory and His gospel. Christ has indeed been raised from the dead. So our message is not meaningless. Our faith is not futile. And our work is not worthless. Therefore, let us stand firm. And can we pray? Father, we thank you for your word to us today. We thank you for, in many ways, bringing us back to basics. We thank you for reminding us that Christ has died for our sins according to the Scriptures. He's been buried but has been raised again according to the Scriptures. That our past is forgiven. That our future is secure. And so, Lord, help us to recommit ourselves to you, to stand firm in your gospel, to glory in your cross, and to serve you with all that you give us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's stand, sing near the cross.
By heaven.
You may be seated. Thank you so much for being with us today again. Thank you to Alan, to everyone who's been followed behind the scenes. We've really appreciated it. Can we remind you, just if God has been speaking to you, if you have been challenged, or if there are things happening in your life that you need to share and you're not sure what to do, then please do reach out to those involved in pastoral ministry at the church. Madeline Mahaffey, myself, are available. You can call us, we can arrange a Zoom call, you might even get a walk if that's possible as well. But we just want to let you know that feel free to do that. If you feel that God is speaking, you'd like someone to come alongside and support, if that's helpful, that's there. In a few moments, the ushers are going to be...